Good morning. Happy Feast of the Holy Trinity. That is what the Church of the Universal Church celebrates today. And that involves, obviously, all of us, community with the divine being, community with the divine life. Quite a few announcements for us today. First of all, if this is your first Sunday back, would you let us know? Welcome back. Second Sunday back. I know there is some excitement about people. Yeah, second Sunday back. Very good. Now, if you are about to leave the community to travel up north for the summer, would you please stand so we can see you and know that this week. Are you leaving this week?
Yes.
This week. Okay. So we know that we will not see you in church, and you're still with us in spirit during the summer. Thank you, and happy and safe travel. All right? We are going to initiate some changes to the liturgy. Not today, but probably you'll see them next week already. I mean, not probably. You will see next week. And what I've changed to the liturgy is that normally we start from the back with the confession and forgiveness as we open the service. But next week, what I'm going to do is we're going to start still in the back with a litany. The confession and forgiveness will happen after we hear scripture. So once scripture has reached us, and we have noticed how God has touched us and how God has convicted us and graced us with forgiveness, then we stand up and confess and get our forgiveness. All right, we'll do that for a period of time, and then we switch back to confession at the beginning. That will give us some variety. By the way, welcome to anybody who is worshiping with us for the first time ever. Do we have any guests in the congregation? People that, yes, I see you with a mask on, but I didn't recognize the hair, so I said, this must be. Welcome, where from?
Right now, from
Heritage. Okay, thank you.
Minnesota.
Okay, very good, welcome. And visiting from? From around here, welcome. Good to have you with us. I scribbled some notes on here, but I can't remember. Okay, that's okay. Skip that. So during the month, we have had very many birthday and wedding anniversaries. I try to reach you all, but if you happen to have a birthday on a Sunday, we want to acknowledge you. All right? So, Ruth, happy birthday. Ruth, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Ruth. Happy birthday to you. And God willing, many more. So happy Memorial Day, everyone. We remember those who have given their life for the country. And we pray for peace, always pray for peace. We have Scott. Last week, you remember, we did a survey, and Scott is here to talk to us again. And then soon after, we'll go into the prelude.
So thank you, Pastor. Last week, could I have the next slide? Last week, we put out a survey, and we're going to do the same thing again today. And the objective here was really to help our church members that like me, felt a little bit of discomfort in coming back to in-person services, feel a lot better understanding that certainly a large percentage of our congregation have been vaccinated. Could I have the next slide? We're going to ask people again today, fill out one of these forms. Even if you filled it out before, we'd really like to get as many of you who feel comfortable participating to participate in this survey. We will report the results back on out at the beginning of the service. You'll see it up in front of you in the bulletin, those types of things. Next slide, if I could. So some early results of at least last week's survey. These results basically show that the overwhelming majority of the members of our church family have been vaccinated. 89% were fully vaccinated. 2% had gotten their first shot. A couple of people had reported that they have not yet been vaccinated but have the COVID antibodies, which gave us about 92% of our church congregation that had been vaccinated or at least had some protection going into there, and only 8% that didn't. I would emphasize that this is by no means a scientific survey. There's a typo at the bottom of this. There's 97 of 131 people, or about 75% of you, chose to participate in this. If you can today, I'm really encouraging as many of you as feel comfortable to participate. Next slide, Ed. But again, participation truly is optional and individual results. Please don't write your name on it. We want to keep this completely anonymous. And last slide, Ed. I'm also going to ask you to reach out and talk to your friends, neighbors about the results of this. I know that I've been talking with my friends and pleased to see folks that previously did not feel comfortable participating in in-person services starting to come back. Exciting to see all new faces out here. And I will encourage all of you, if you could put your surveys, there's a blue box out as you walk on out the door, or if you don't see that, just put it in the basket where you put your offertory. Thank you.
Thank you.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy.
Amen.
Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us.
It is hard to believe that there is enough to share.
We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus the manna from heaven you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
For peace in the world, for the health of the church, that we may live out truth and justice and grace. Let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. Peace in our hearts, for peace in our homes, for friends and family, for life and for love, for our work and our play. Let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. Center our lives in the water and the word, that you nourish our souls with your body and blood. Let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord.
Let us pray. Almighty Creator and ever-living God, we worship your glory, eternal three in one, and we praise your power, majestic one in three. Keep us steadfast in this faith, defend us in all adversity, and bring us at last into your presence, where you live in endless joy and love, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
Praise the Spirit, three. Reading from the book of Isaiah. In the year that King Uzzah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the threshold shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am. Send me." This is the word of the Lord.
Ascribe to the Lord, you gods. Ascribe to the glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due God's name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is upon the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is a powerful voice. The voice of the Lord is a voice of splendor. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedar trees. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. The Lord makes Lebanon skin like a calf, and Mount Hermon like a young wild ox. The voice of the
flashes.
The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh.
The voice of the Lord makes the oak trees rise and strips the forest bare. And in the temple of the Lord, all are crying glory.
The Lord sits enthroned above the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as a king forevermore.
O Lord, give strength to your people. Give them, O Lord, the blessings of peace.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. Word of God, word of life. Please.
Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. And Jesus answered him, Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, How can these things be? Jesus answered him, Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
be to you, Lord. Please be seated. The sermon today will be delivered by our deacon, Charlotte Downing. She kindly agreed to work on this sermon already last year. But because we shut down for the pandemic, that was put on hold. So she's been sitting on this sermon for a long time. And now we have the chance to hear it.
I don't know that it got any better being aged over a year. But may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Today is another festival of the church year, which is at times forgotten. Today is Holy Trinity Sunday. You may ask, what is that, the Holy Trinity? Well, it's not an event like Christmas or Easter. It is a doctrine of the church we believe in deeply. While the developed doctrine of the Trinity is not explicit in the Bible, nor is that word, Trinity, used, it does mention the three persons of the Trinity many times. For example, my greeting this morning. And also in Matthew 28:19, also known as the Great Commission. Ephesians 4:4-6. The first letter of Peter 1:2, to name a few others. An early Christian church father, Tertullian, was the first to explain and defend the Trinity in the early 3rd century. Over a century later, the Council of Nicaea confirmed the Trinity as official church doctrine. The concept of the Trinity can be confusing, but is also a most unique, defining, and awesome mystery. But if we look at its parts, that may help explain what it is and what it isn't. At times, we begin worship by saying, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Or, blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sins, whose mercy endures forever. That is our calling upon the name of Jesus. But it is more than just Jesus whom we call to our worship. It is the Holy Trinity, God in three persons, who comes to our worship and abides with us. God is three, and at the same time, one. We say in the Apostles' Creed, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. We believe in God the Creator. We believe in the God who made everything, this planet and each thing on and in it, the beautiful stars in the night sky, the sun, the moon, and each one of us. We believe in a God who loved us enough to send his Son to earth and die for us. God is loving and compassionate, wanting what is only good for us, his children. But we want a God we can understand and control on our own terms. As Harry Emerson Fosdick once described him, a cosmic bellhop God for whom we can press a button to get things. But our God is bigger than that. Our God cannot be controlled nor manipulated for personal glory or reward. Our God is more than just one God. And that brings us to the second part of the Trinity, God, who is Jesus Christ. We say, I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. Our God is not only the God who created the universe, but our God became human, and our God became Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and rose again. We say that we are Christians, and the first six letters of that word are C-H-R-I-S-T. Not God, but Christ. For we believe in God, who became Christ and died for us. Our God is more than a creator. He is the giver of life, now and in the future. We have a God in Jesus who came to earth and taught us to love our neighbors as ourselves. He taught us not to judge others, but to treat them with kindness and humility. We reach out to the last, the lost, and the least, and all our brothers and sisters with hands of compassion, mercy, and inclusive acceptance. At Nativity, we provide a food pantry and free clothing to those in need and to migrant farm workers in Dade City, gifts and food to children of prisoners with the Angel Tree Project, Days for Girls, many quilts and shawls for Lutheran Word Relief, cards, calls, visitors to the homebound and those living in care facilities, and so many other ministries. We are reaching out for and to Christ as we carry light and love to the world. We then say, I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. This, then, is the third part of the Trinity. We believe in a God who became a spirit, who dwells in each believer. For at our baptism, we were given the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not a thing that fills us like water, but the Holy Spirit is a person, the third part of the Trinity. The Holy Spirit is not an influence, a substance, or a power like electricity. We even tend to refer to the Holy Spirit as it, forgetting that the Holy Spirit is the third person in the blessed Holy Trinity. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is the Spirit himself bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may be glorified with him, from Romans. When we cry to God for anything, it is the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, giving our own spirit of understanding and awareness the grounds it needs to believe in the God who is three in one. We pray to God through the Spirit, and in the words of Andrew Murray, true prayer is the living experience of the Holy Trinity, the Spirit's breathing, the Son's intercession, and the Father's will. These three become one in us. The Trinity is not a vague doctrinal experience, but it is personal. The Trinity of God relating to each of us on a personal level. The Trinity is not a puzzle to be solved, but a relationship to be lived. The name of our God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That is three. Yes, but only one. We do believe. Amen.
And so let us speak of our faith in the Trinity with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us come before the triune God in prayer. We pray, O God, for your holy church around the world. Revitalize and renew us, that we may be reborn once again through the waters of baptism and the blowing wind of your Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks for your power revealed to us in creation, for cedar and oak trees, for rushing waters, for the echoes of thunder. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the nations and our leaders, that led by your Spirit, they work toward a world where all of your children enjoy peace. We pray especially for the nations currently experiencing war or turmoil. including Lebanon, Mali, and Syria. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for healing for all those who suffer, especially victims and survivors of trauma or violence. Give respite to those living with PTSD or any other mental health concerns. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our worshiping community, that the splendor of your majesty and the holiness of your mystery may be glorified through our worship and our relationships with one another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks, O God, for those who have died in faith. We remember also those whose lives have been lost due to the horrors of war. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your abiding grace.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us offer each other a sign of God's peace. As we prepare the altar, we bring together gifts that God has given us, the work of human hand, fruits of the earth, bread and wine, gifts that God gives to nurture us, to bless us with, to draw us closer to Him, to help us become one with God. Let us bring our offerings to the altar now, but also later when you exit the church, you may drop off your offering in the basket, or during the week, you can mail it in or bring it to the office.
Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world. Amen.
Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, O God of the universe.
Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age.
Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth, Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ.
Praise to you for your Spirit, for God, and all nations.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth, burning with justice, peace, and love. With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us pray the prayer Christ himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the glory, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Christ has set the table with more than enough for all. Come. Body and blood of Christ given for you. Please be seated. You may consume the elements now together along with me. Please stand. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen. Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen.
The blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us be upon you now and forever.
Amen.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great.
People of Nativity, what is our mission? With the birth of Jesus in our hearts, we carry light and love to the world. Go in peace. You are the body of Christ. Thanks be to God.